Praise the Lord, everyone. This is Pastor and Prophet Eric Clark from Remnants of Fire Ministries. I pray everybody is doing great on tonight. I'm here to testify that Jesus is Lord. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is our Savior. He is our Redeemer. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. And I just thank and I praise Him on today. The Lord is so good. He's so kind. And He has a powerful word for us tonight. God is just good. I pray that everybody is doing well. I pray that everybody is allowing the life and the glory of Jesus Christ to manifest through them, because that is what He is doing for us in this hour. He is manifesting His glory through us. I believe that's what it talks about in Zechariah 8 and 23, that they shall see the glory on us. And Paul also talks about it in Corinthians when, you know, he talks about for our light affliction is not to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. The glory that's getting ready to be revealed through us is the glory of Jesus Christ, and it is rich in mercy. That means that Jesus is going to supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory. No matter what goes on in the economy, no matter what goes on with resources, the glory of Jesus Christ is going to feed us in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank You on tonight. We worship You. We praise You. We adore You. We magnify You. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. We lift You up. We thank You, Jesus. Jesus, speak Your word through us on tonight. Bless us on tonight. We just thank You. Fill every household with Your glory. Fill every community, every neighborhood with Your power and Your glory. In Jesus' name. All right, let's get into it. I was reading today, studying and reading the pseudographic of the lost books of the Bible today. The Holy Spirit has been leading me into reading those books because He wants to give us a lot of revelation out of it. And He told me to read the book of the letter of Peter to Philip. So I'm like, okay, Lord, let me see what this is about. And He led me to read it today. I've looked at it a few times, but I just never, you know, had any interest, or I was never led of the Spirit to read it. But it's in the lost books of the pseudographica, so I read it and it blessed me today. And the Holy Spirit wanted me to talk about it. So He showed me some things that is very important for the body of Christ. So we're going to read here in the pseudographica, the lost books of the Bible, the letter of Peter to Philip. This is very interesting, very powerful. It says, Peter, the apostle of Jesus Christ, to Philip, our beloved brother and our fellow apostle, to the brethren who are with you, greetings. Now I want you to know, our brother, that we receive orders from our Lord and the Savior of the whole world, that we should come together to give instructions and preaching in the salvation which was promised us by our Lord Jesus Christ. But as for you, you were separate from us, and you did not desire to come together to know how we should organize ourselves in order that we might tell the good news. So basically, he's telling him, Peter is telling Philip that you weren't around at that time so that we can come together in the unity of the faith, so that we could spread the good news of Jesus Christ. He said, therefore, would it be agreeable to you, our brother, to come according to the orders of our God Jesus? When Philip had received these words, and when he had read them, he went to Peter, rejoicing with gladness. Then Peter gathered the others also. They went up upon the mountain, which is called the Mount Olives, the place where they used to gather with blessed Christ when he was in the body. So basically, this mountain, that the Mount of Olives, is where they, where these brothers gather together, and this is a place where they gather with Christ when he was in the flesh. It says, then when the apostles had come together and had known themselves upon their knees, they prayed the same, Father, Father, Father of lights, who possesses the incorruptions. It says, Father, Father, Father of the light, who possesses the incorruptions. Hear us just as thou hast taken pleasure in the Holy Child, Jesus Christ. For he became for us an illuminator in darkness. Yea, hear us. And they prayed again another time, saying, Son of life, Son of immortality, who is in the light, Son, Christ of immortality, our Redeemer, give us power, for they seek to kill us. Then a great light appeared so that the mountain shone from the sight of him who had appeared. And a voice called out to them, saying, Listen to my words that I may speak to you. Why are you asking me? I am Jesus Christ, who am with you forever. Then the apostles answered and said, Lord, we would like to know the deficiency of the aeons and the pleroma. Now, I'm going to give you the definition of what aeons and pleroma is. Okay. All right, the pleroma is the totality of the fullness of the Godhead which Christ dwells in. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to go to 1 Corinthians 2 and 9, because this really helped me understand 1 Corinthians 2 and 9, okay? Because last week, the Holy Spirit was just dealing with me about us being alive in Christ, okay? And the Lord is leading us to a realm to where we are alive in the Spirit of Christ, okay? Not having nothing to do with the flesh, but just being alive in his glory, being alive through his life, because Paul also says in Colossians that we, that Christ is our life, right? So Colossians 2, verse 9, it says, For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, who, in whom also ye circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. So basically, we are complete. It's in Christ, is it dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. We are complete in Christ. And Christ is the head of all principality and power. And we are circumcised, with the circumcision made without hands. That means the Holy Spirit has circumcised us, right? And in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. So we are being, our flesh is being done away with right now in this hour. And we're going to walk in the Spirit, in the totality of his Spirit, okay? And then it goes on to say, we are buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who hath raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he hath quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he had made show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. He's talking about the rulers of darkness and all of that. But we also see, going up to verse 3, now let's go to verse 2, because this is going to deal with what we're talking about in the book of the letter of Peter to Philip. Verse 2 of Colossians 2, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And it says, unless I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words, right? All right, so our hearts are being comforted together in love with the full assurance of the mysteries of God in Christ. But in Christ is hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, okay? So that's what pleroma means, okay? It's talking about the totality of the fullness of the Godhead of Christ, okay? If you look in the Webster's Dictionary, it's talking about the fullness and divine excellency and powers, right? The fullness of being of a divine life, all right? So, got that out of the way. All right, so where are we in the book of the letter of Peter to Philip? All right, okay. So then a voice came to them out of the light saying, it is you yourselves who are witnesses that I spoke all these things to you. But because of your unbelief, I shall speak again. So this is what Christ is saying to them. First of all, concerning the deficiency of the aeons. Wait a minute, where am I? Oh, right. Okay, I did read, and the apostles answered and said, Lord, we would like to know the deficiency. Right, so the apostles said, Lord, we would like to know the deficiency of the aeons and the pleroma. Okay, I skipped something. Sorry about that. Okay, I gave you the definition of the pleroma. Now I got to give you the definition of the aeons. This is very interesting. Okay, the aeons, A-E, that's A-E. O-N. Okay. All right. Aeons is an indefinite and very long period of time, often a period exaggerated by humorous or rhetorical effect. Also a unit of time equal to a billion years. A major division of geological time subdivided into eras. Okay. A power existing from eternity. An emanation or phase of a supreme deity. Okay? An immeasurably or indefinitely long period of time, a very long division of geological time. Right, I read that. Okay. So that's what aeon means. Okay? So, right. So it said the apostles answered and said, Lord, we'd like to know the deficiency of the aeons and the pleroma. And how are we detained in this dwelling place? So the apostles was asking the Lord, how are we detained in this dwelling place? And then they say further, how do we come into this? How did we come to this place? And then they said, and, I guess they asked the Lord a lot of questions. They're like, and, blah, 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 and, blah, blah, blah. And they say, and in what manner shall we depart? And then they say, again, how do we have the authority of boldness? And why do the powers fight against us? So this is basically showing us. Now, they didn't ask, how many questions they asked? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They asked about 4 or 5 questions to the Lord. They want to know, which is what we need to be asking the Lord right now. Why are these things happening? What's going on? You know, we really need to know, because in some circles we probably have been lied to through different religions about what's going to happen, and then it's not. But the Lord, we know the Lord gets the last say, because his word has to be fulfilled, right? Then it says, then a voice came to them out of the light saying, it is you yourselves who are witnesses that I spoke all these things to you. But because of your unbelief, I shall speak again. First of all, concerning the deficiency of the aeons. This is a deficiency. When the disobedience and the foolishness of the mother appeared without the commandment of the majesty of the Father. Now, it's talking about the disobedience of Eve, Adam and Eve right now. But it says, when the disobedience and the foolishness of the mother appeared without the commandment of the majesty of the Father, she wanted to raise up aeons. And when she spoke, the arrogant one followed. That's talking about Satan, right? And when she left behind a part, the arrogant one, which is Satan, laid hold of it, and it became a deficiency. This is a deficiency of the aeons. Now, when the arrogant one, which is Satan, had taken a part, he sold it, and he placed powers over it and authorities, and he enclosed it in the aeons, which are dead. And all the powers of the world rejoice that they have been begotten. But they do not know the pre-existent Father, since they are strangers to him. But this is the one to whom they gave power and whom they served by praising him. But he, the arrogant one, which is Satan, became proud on account of the praise of the powers. He became an envier. And he wanted to make an image in the place of an image, and a form in the place of a form. And he commissioned the powers within his authority to mold mortal bodies. And they became to be form, they came to be a misrepresentation from the sublance which had emerged, right? Now the Lord is getting ready to talk to them about the pleroma. He said, now concerning the pleroma, I am the one who was sent down in the body because of the seed which had fallen away. And I came down into their mortal mold, but they did not recognize me. They were thinking of me that I was a mortal man. And I spoke with him who belongs to me, and he hearkened to me just as you two who hearken today. And I gave him authority in order that he might enter into the inheritance of the fatherhood. And I took, they were filled in his salvation. And since he was a deficiency for this reason, he became a pleroma. All right. It is because of this that you are being detained, because you belong to me. So the Lord is beginning to explain to the apostles that you are being detained by these evil forces because you belong to me, right? He said, when you strip off from yourselves what is corrupted, then you will become illuminators in the midst of mortal men. That means taking off the corruptible and putting on incorruptible, right? Oh my God, he said, when you strip off from yourself what is corrupted, then you will become illuminators in the midst of mortal men. And this is the reason that you will fight against the powers, because they do not have rest like you, since they do not wish that you be saved, right? Then the apostles worship again, saying, Lord, tell us, in what way shall we fight against the archons? Since the archons are above us. Now, the archons are evil demonic forces, okay? It says, then a voice called out to them from the appearance, saying, now you will fight against them in this way. For the archons are fighting against the inner man. It's talking about our spirit man. And you are to fight against them in this way. Come together and teach in the world the salvation with a promise. Now listen to what he's saying. He said, now you will fight against them in this way. For the archons are fighting against the inner man, which means the archons are trying to come against the spirit man of the believers of Jesus Christ. Now I was looking at a video today where this brother was talking about how the archons are parasites, right? And he was talking about how when you eat food that, he said, when you eat lower nature food and you're eating food that you should not eat, he said, the archons, they come to you more. So this is why the Spirit of Truth in the last few or several years has been teaching us how to eat. If you notice, a lot of people are starting to, you got people that are starting to drink turmeric powder. People are drinking burdock root tea. People are drinking lavender tea. People are drinking things, you know, people are becoming vegan because they're trying to lose weight. Because a lot of, you know, because food is spiritual. What we put in our bodies is spiritual, okay? So the Spirit of Truth is awakening us with what we should eat, what we should drink, right? So it says, for the archons are fighting against the inner man, and you are to fight against them in this way. Come together and teach in the world the salvation with a promise. And you, gird yourselves with the power of my Father, and let your prayers be known. And he, the Father, will help you as he has helped you by sending me. Be not afraid. I am with you forever. As I previously said to you when I was in the body. Then there came lightning and thunder from heaven. And what happened to them in that place was taken up to heaven. Then the apostles gave thanks to the Lord with every blessing. And they returned to Jerusalem. And while coming up, they spoke with each other on the road concerning the light which had came. And a remark was made concerning the Lord. It was said, if he, our Lord, suffered, then how much must we suffer? Peter answered, saying, he suffered on our behalf, and it is necessary for us to suffer because of our smallness. Then a voice came to them saying, I have told you many times, it is necessary for you to suffer. It is necessary that you bring you to synagogue, that they bring you to synagogues and governors so that you will suffer. But he who does not suffer and does not the Father in order that he may. So that you may suffer, but he who does not suffer. Okay. It said that the apostles rejoiced greatly and came up to Jerusalem, and they came up to the temple and gave instruction in salvation in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they healed a multitude. And Peter opened his mouth. He said to his fellow disciples, did our Lord Jesus, when he was in the body, show us everything? For he came down, my brothers, listen to my voice, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He spoke thus, our illuminator, Jesus, came down and was crucified. And he bore a crown of thorns, and he put on a purple garment, and he was crucified on a tree, and he was buried in a tomb, and he rose from the dead. My brothers, Jesus is a stranger to this suffering, but we are the ones who have suffered through the transgression of our mother. And because of this, he did everything like us, for the Lord Jesus, the Son of the immeasurable glory of the Father. He is the author of our life. My brothers, let us therefore not obey these lawless ones and walk in. Then Peter gathered together the others also saying, O Lord Jesus Christ, author of our rest, give us a spirit of understanding in order that we may perform wonders. Then Peter and the other apostles saw him, and they were filled with a Holy Spirit. And each one performed healings, and they parted in order to preach the Lord Jesus. And they came together and greeted each other, saying, Amen. Then Jesus appeared, saying to them, peace to you all and everyone who believes in my name. And when you depart, joy be to you in grace and power. And be not afraid. Behold, I am with you forever. Then the apostles parted from each other into four words, in order to preach, and they went by a power of Jesus in peace. So I thought when I read this today, I said, Jesus, you're doing something. The Lord is doing something with his people. He's bringing us together. He said, come together and teach in the world the salvation with a promise. And then he said, and you gird yourselves with the power of my Father, and let your prayers be known, and he, the Father, will help you as he has helped you by sending me. So I believe the Lord is doing something great in this hour. We know he is. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. Where it's talking about the unity in the body. Ephesians 4:1. He said, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you are worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. This is what the Lord is doing, especially with him restoring the family, with marriages, right? Endeavoring to keep the unity of the spirit and bond of peace, right? There is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through you all and in you all. Okay? That's powerful. What else I want to read? Galatians 5:24. Ooh. Right? When Paul talks about living by the Spirit, right? Verse 16, then I say, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to the one to the another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I've told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Okay? Thank you, Lord. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15. Let's start at verse 20. 1 Corinthians 15:20. He says, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that sleep, that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward that they are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and authority and power. For he must reign till he have put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, right? For he hath put all things under his feet. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is expected, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So remember when we were saying in Colossians that he made a fool, what did he say? He said in Colossians 2:15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made show of them openly, triumphing over them in it, right? Right. Let's go down to verse 53. 1 Corinthians 15:53, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. All right, let's go 1 Peter 1:4. Let's start at verse 3. First, I'm sorry, 2 Peter 1, verse 3. Right? 2 Peter 1, verse 3. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. So he's calling us to glory and virtue, right? Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. So now we're living in a time where the Lord is getting ready to show us his promises. I know a lot of us probably have been lied to and probably been promised a lot of things, and the Lord, and it's not the Lord's will. So the Lord is showing us, he said, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. Praise the Lord, sis. That by these things you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to your virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and has forgotten that he was purged from that old sin. Thank you, Lord. So this is a time where the Lord is allowing his glory to manifest through us, as when we was reading in the book of Peter. Let me pronounce that right. It says the letter of Peter to Philip. So virtue, glory, precious promises. Okay, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. That's why the Lord wants us to walk in the spirit and not the flesh. Putting off corruption and putting on incorruption. So the Lord is burning away our flesh with his fire. Every time we seek him and come to him, the Lord is breaking us from our flesh and having us to walk in the spirit. Walking by faith and not by sight. I'm learning in my life that I'm learning that I have to continue to fight and to press and to push and to persevere and to endure and to travail in the spirit in order to receive his precious promises. Because when we are in our flesh, the enemy is not fighting us. You know, when we're in our flesh, we're like, oh, it's whatever. Because when you're in your flesh, you're just grabbing hold to anything that's tangible, right? But when the Lord gives you a prophetic word and he's promising you something, there's a fight. And that's how it works. And the Lord allows it to be a fight because he wants us to travail, persevere, and endure in the spirit so that when we keep coming to him, we are allowing his spirit and his life and his glory to manifest through us. That's what I'm learning personally for me. I got to keep pressing. And we got to be pressed. That's what a prophetess was talking about this morning. I forget the prophetess' name. But she was talking about being pressed and that oil coming out. She was talking about, she was showing a jar of olives, and then she showed a jar of olive oil, and she was saying how the Lord has to press us. So we're going to always be pressed as long as we are in Christ. Okay, I think that's about it that I want to talk about. But brothers and sisters, if you're led of the Spirit, read the book of the letter of Peter to Philip in the Pseudepigraphica. It's very powerful. I enjoy reading that today. Okay? Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you, Lord. We cut off the head of every witch and warlock spirit. We burn every witch and warlock demon with the fire and the sword and the anointing of Jesus Christ. Lord, bless that this word will penetrate the hearts of your people and they will walk in it in Jesus' name. All right, brothers and sisters, I love you all. Have a blessed night. God bless you.